Okay, I think we're back live and hopefully the sound will work this time. There's always some technical issues, but anyway, welcome to Stockholm Chess Challenge. This is the biggest youth tournament we have in Sweden, and hopefully everything will be working all right here. It's the biggest youth tournament we have in Sweden, and we have the brightest talents we have in Sweden, and we have a couple of players from USN, A in Norway, Canada, basically all over the world, and they're fighting for IM Norms, Grandmaster Norms, depending on which title and goal they have. And we can at least start looking at the games already. We have Erik Blomqvist, who is of course the Swedish champion right now. He's not really a junior, he's still young, but he's not a junior. And he's playing Sebastian Mihailov from Norway, who I know both of them. I know Erik quite well. Sebastian not as much, but I know he's quite talented and he has some interesting ideas in the opening. I've spoken to him a couple of times and it's an interesting game. And of course, Erik is a grandmaster. He's trying to cross the 2600 mark and he's had a fantastic 2016 and hopefully he will continue this soon. But anyway, he's a very strong player and you see, this opening is not really typical for Erik because he's usually an e4 player. He knows a lot of these, the real opus with d3 is played a couple of times. He's quite well prepared usually, but here he plays something unusual, perhaps because it's the first round of the tournament, so he's not trying to gain some advantage. He just wants some position to play, and we see here that Mihailov is going for the King's Indian, which is, of course, is a very aggressive opening, and we will probably see a very good fighting game here. But we see here that White can of course play c4 and we have the fianchetto variation of the King's Indian, which loads of theory. I can't even begin to tell where the variations start, but this is of course very theoretical, and we see that Blomqvist tries to avoid these lines. I've never even seen him play that variation, I think. He plays b3 instead, which is actually quite decent. White is just trying to develop the pieces, bishop b2, trying to neutralize the strong bishop on g7, and just develop the pieces. And it's sort of directed against this move e5, which Black tries to play sometimes. He could even play it now, I think, but we see that Mihailov is trying something else. He plays bishop f5, end of the bishop b2, queen c8. This is all very natural. Black is trying to play bishop h3, trying to eliminate this bishop on g2. Which is of course very strong, it's pointing down to b7. But of course, this has all been played before. Strangely, I think I even saw a game with this variation this morning or even yesterday. But anyway, I think both of these players have seen this before. It's not very theoretical, it's a position to play, but nothing special. Bishop h3, so White doesn't really care about this trade, it just develops the pieces and there's nothing wrong with the position, I think. c5 is very natural, trying to. He's breaking in the center now that e5 is not really possible, he's trying to for c5 instead. But after d5, we have this structure, kind of Benoni-like structure, but it should be perhaps slightly more convenient for White. We have this very nice pawn structure, and we can later on play for e4, e5. Black can of course try to play a6, b5, e6 not really so much because the d6 pawn is not so good after e6, but a6 of course very natural and White just prevents b5 by playing a4 himself. All of this looks very natural, but now Mihailov plays a move that looks very strange to me. I'm not really sure what the idea is. He plays queen g4 and this is actually completely new to me. I haven't seen this before. I'm trying to figure out what the idea could be. I could of course play something like queen h5, which would be a decent square for the queen, but I was thinking if maybe he wanted to play knight e4 at some point, but no, it doesn't really strike me as the idea. I'm not really sure why he's playing queen g4. I guess we will see. Anyway, Blomqvist just keeps on developing queen d2, also protects the bishop on b2, which could be important in some variations. Knight d7, and here we see that Blomqvist actually takes on h3 and just goes knight g5, and Okay, I still don't think it's nothing too special, but the queen on h3. Not really sure if it's that good. It's not really in danger of being trapped, I mean, but still a structure. I'd say this is still slightly better for white. Nothing, I mean, terrible for black, but I think Blomqvist is pretty happy with the position, and yeah, I mean, we have an interesting game. Best man will win the game, of course. So far, yeah, I think, yeah, he played queen h5. Yeah, it feels like slightly better for Blomqvist, but nothing special. But of course, he's the favorite going into the game. He's high rated. Mihailov is he's a young, I think he has one or two international master norms, and his rating is very close to 2400. But yeah, Blomqvist should be the stronger player, but it doesn't always matter at the board. And we have another young Norwegian. I don't know much about Andreas Trygvestad. There are a lot of Norwegians coming up, but I'm not really sure I have checked up on all of them. But yeah, he seems like a strong player. He is about 2300. I think he's 14 years old. If I remember correctly, he was not supposed to play in this tournament because his parents didn't want him to play by himself, but in the end they let him go. But anyway, in the first round he's playing a very strong opponent, Adam Tokayev. I think he's Russian. He's a strong grandmaster, about 2500, and he's used to playing in the Swedish tournaments because he's been playing for Örgryte for quite a couple of years. We're actually playing Örgryte in a couple of weeks, and hopefully he will not be on their team because he's their strongest player by far. But here, well, we have the Sicilian, of course, and Trygvestad plays c3, the Alapin variation, and I gotta say, this is one of the variations I don't like about the Sicilian, because c3 is not really dangerous theoretically, I think, but it's kind of frustrating to play against if, well, like in this case, a young 2300 player just want, if white just wants a draw, there's quite a lot of forced variations that end in a drawish position, and yeah, I'm not really. I haven't really found anything I like too much for black, even though it's mostly because I'm too lazy to look it up. But yeah, we see one of the main lines being played here. The other one would be, of course, to play d5 and move 2 instead of knight f6, but knight f6 is what the grandmasters usually play. e5, knight d5, d4, this has all been played before, and now white plays knight f3 because we don't really need to take on d4 immediately. And this way we can even play bishop c4 first if we want to. d6, this has all been played many times before, and here Tokayev actually plays d takes e5, which I'm not really familiar with at this point. I know this line with knight c6 and bishop c4 at this point, and now d takes e5 is it's not the main move, but it's actually really interesting. It's one of the moves I like the most for black, but I'm not really sure what's the big difference if we take on e5 immediately. White could of course take with a knight when we have some he has an isolated pawn on d4, but yeah, usually it's maybe knight c6 can be played, and yeah, bishop c4 is probably usually what you play here anyway, but it could lead to this structure, which should be of course all right for black. But you know, it's a position to play. I don't think it's too terrible for white either. He takes e5, and now we get this variation, which I think is quite interesting to play with black. But Tokayev keeps avoiding the main lines here. I think knight b4 is what they usually play. I've seen some game by Anish Giri, I think. Okay, I'm not really sure it was Giri, but yeah, could have been Vasiliy Lagrav, but yeah, anyway, knight b4 is the main move, and well, if we take on d8 and play this endgame, white has to be kind of careful because this pawn on e5. Even though the position is usually like equal objectively, the end game is usually easier for black to play than white because this pawn on e5 is not so strong. But anyway, knight b6, I'm not sure. Tokayev is probably trying to throw his opponent out of the book. That's probably what's going on. But anyway, it's a position. I highly doubt that black is worse. We get some kind of end game here as well. a6, Yeah, I think this is one of the end games where black is doing quite well in practice, because even though the position is objectively fine for white, I mean, there's a lot of opportunities to outplay your opponent. And yeah, we see after a6, white found this in-between move, bishop e3, threatening the knight on b6, which looks quite clever, but let's see what's going on. Bishop takes b5 was played, knight takes b5. I'm not sure if this is theory still. It seems like both players have been playing rather quickly, but probably not theory. And, well, of course, white is threatening at fork on c7 and the knight on b6. White, you could, of course, take on b5, perhaps what you should play. Take on b6, and now, I don't know, knight c6, perhaps. This looks alright for black. We have an open a-line for a-file for the rook. e6 will be played. Maybe even g6, but I think e6, but yeah, king e2. It looks like a game. Nothing too special for any side, but yeah, I think Tokayev is quite satisfied with the position. I mean, he has decent opportunities to play this for a win, I think. The structure doesn't look fantastic, but I mean, the pawns aren't really weak. They can't be picked up anytime soon, and the pawn on a2 is more annoying because, well, the rook has to stay on a1, and if you play for a3, you have to look out for b4 at some point, and even the squares on c4 and b3 can be quite weak. So I think, yeah, I think the position is equal, but I think Tokayev is satisfied. Yeah, he can play this for a win for sure. Then of course we have another strong grandmaster. We have Majorov from, I think, Belarus, and he's playing Theodor Tkhanovskoy, who's my old, well, I could say childhood friend, of course. I know him extremely well from the first day I started playing chess, actually. So, yeah, I know Theodor really well. And, yeah, we also, in our youth, we also started openings together and pretty much all chess together, which means we both played the Grünfeld quite a lot. And, yeah, of course, we have the Fianchetto variation of the Grünfeld, where white plays knight f3 at this point. Of course, we have some other options, like taking on d5. This has been played a lot. Now we have e4, and we have knight f3. It's extremely theoretical. Knight f3 has become quite popular lately, because I think Kramnik has played it in a couple of games in the last 2 years, at least. And this is a well-known variation where, yeah, when knight f3 is played, you usually take on c4, and after knight f3 trying to get back the pawn, you can play this move c3, and usually white would try to avoid having this pawn on c3. He would rather take it back with the knight and keep control of e5 and c5 squares. But after c3, take and c5, the structure is not that fantastic for white. Black will play knight c6 and try and, well, maybe even knight d5 at some point, trying to attack this pawn formation. It's very interesting, actually. Castling, e3. If I'm reminded correctly, I had this exact position. Maybe he didn't play e3, but I played this position with black in a tournament in Denmark a couple of years ago against Theodor, when Theodor was playing this variation with white. And I think, well, I think Theodor got some advantage against me in that game, but we played it quite quickly to a draw, because we were both having a horrible tournament and we just wanted to half a point. Even though we usually fight it out against each other, we were both kind of not really in the mood for playing chess, so we just drew that game. Anyway, e3, knight c6. I'm not really sure what the line was with that Kramnik played. Did he play e3? I can't say that I'm completely sure. e3, knight c6. Anyway, it's supposed to be okay for black, but there are a lot of nuances you have to know. It's not that easy to play with black. There's a lot of theory and new ideas for white. So I think some of the games were with an early bishop b2, but I can't say that I remember all this stuff here. Queen e2 was played, of course, very natural. The rook d1 is supposed to be played anytime soon, and I think the move I like to play was knight d5, trying to hit this pawn on c3. I'm just trying to remember some ideas here, and after bishop b2, You could play this move knight b6. I remember this from reading a book by Alexander Belchev and Yevgeny August. I really like this maneuver from f6 to d5 to b6 to a4, and suddenly they try to attack White's queenside. I'm not really sure this is the best variation. I'm sure Theodor has better knowledge of this than I have, but anyway, he plays the bishop f5, which of course is a main move as well. The bishop could even go to e4 later on, trying to neutralize the bishop on g2, where, well, on e4 it would be perfectly placed. And we see after rook d1 he did play bishop e4 immediately. And yeah, I mean, I kind of like Black's position, probably because I used to play the Grünfeld myself, but there's nothing too special going on, I think. Later on, you could even consider a structure like c takes, and put the queen on d5, just blocking everything on the light squares. It looks completely fine for Black, but yeah, I mean, it's a position to play, I guess. You also have to watch out a bit, because White has more pawns in the center, and yeah, we will see. Bishop b2. Maybe White will try to get rid of this bishop on e4 somehow, maybe knight c4, knight d2 at some point. Doesn't look too threatening, but it could be an idea. The bishop on e4 is quite strong here, so I like the way Theodor has played it so far. Queen b6. Yeah, it looks natural. I mean, this bishop on b2 is not perfectly placed. You can't play rook b1 because of the bishop. And if knight c4, I guess you can just go queen a6, and this is quite annoying. Pin on the light squares, but yeah, okay, that's what happened. Knight c4, queen a6. Ah, okay, this is an interesting move. He played Majorov played bishop f1, which of course it looks strange because the bishop was so nice on g2, but I mean, the bishop is pointing kind of against the queen on a6, and later on you can move this knight so and try and get rid of this knight, bishop on e4. So maybe this bishop f1 idea is strong. I'm not sure if this is still theory, but it could be, actually. It could be. Knight takes a5 anyway, and it seems like we have a couple of trades going on, but somehow White managed to get rid of the bishop on e4. So I think bishop a4. Yeah, this doesn't look, strike me as completely perfect for Black. And especially now after knight b3, the queen is threatened, the pawn on c5 is threatened, and yeah, I mean, Black's pretty much have to take on b3, and we have the structure queen b6, bishop a3. White is slightly better here, I'm sure. He has the bishop pair. Not really sure if the structure is much better, but the bishop pair is really strong in this kind of position. I think, unfortunately, I'm hoping for Ken Escoque to win, of course, because I'm extremely biased, but I'm not really happy with this position. It feels like he will be suffering for quite a while, and knowing Theodore, he also has a tendency to get into time trouble. We were extremely different in that kind of way because, well, I never get into time trouble, but he always gets into time trouble. And he's already, well, 15 minutes behind on time, which isn't horrible, but yeah, I'm not really keen on having his position. It feels like Majorov has a very nice position against Ken Escoque, unfortunately. And yeah, I'm also gonna, yeah, there are a lot of interesting games I'm gonna look at. That's the most interesting thing about the tournament, is I know all the players, so I will I know quite a lot about their openings and what they play and what they don't like, and even stories about, yeah, pretty much anything. I can't really tell too many stories, because they will not be too happy with me, but anyway, I know them really well. I'm not really sure what game we should look at next, but let's try this one. We have Jonathan Westerberg is of course one of the most talented players Sweden has, perhaps the second most talented after Nils Grandelius, but anyway, he has been playing chess for quite a while, and he's a strong international master, and he wants to be a grandmaster, of course. He has one grandmaster norm, but he's still not that close. He's crossed 2500, but he has some problems getting the grandmaster norms, and he's not playing much this last couple of months anyway, because yeah, he's been focusing on his studies, and he already moved to a small Swedish town called Växjö, where he, well, studies. I'm not really sure what he's studying in Växjö, but he's not playing as much. Hopefully he will get a Grandmaster Norm here, but of course he has to win the first game. And he's playing black against Rakesh from, I believe, India. And I know that a couple of years ago, Westerberg played the Junior World Championship in India, and it was the worst tournament of his life. Well, of course, if you want to know why, you can just look up the results, but in the first game he lost against a 10-year-old kid, who turned out to be a very strong player. And I mean, these kids from India are extremely underrated, and I mean, yeah, I went to India myself, and I don't want to go back anytime soon. I'm still traumatized. And anyway, he said that, yeah, we played in a tournament in London together a couple of months ago, and he said that next time we'll play Indian player, I'll not play. I'll just leave, walk over or something. But it seems like he's playing, even though he's playing an Indian player. Of course, in this tournament, you have to have about 2200 in Hilo to play, so he's not risking losing to any kids with extremely low rating, but yeah. Well, of course, we have to go back and look at the opening, because this is very interesting to see Westerberg's openings. A couple of years ago, he was extremely aggressive. He played gambits, and he also wrote a small article about the Westerberg gambit, which goes like this, but of course, I don't think he has played it yet. Anyway, he has always interesting ideas in the opening, and b6 is one of those openings. He just plays chess. I mean, he's not extremely theoretical, but he has his own ideas, and that's one of his strong points. I think it's quite difficult to really catch him in the opening. You could figure out which opening he plays, but you won't get much out of the opening against him. It used to be his biggest weakness, but I mean, he's worked on it quite a lot, and yeah, he usually plays this b6, and it kind of proves that it's not that bad, and I kind of have to agree with him. He has played this a lot of times, actually. We played in a team game. We played for the same team in Stockholm, and we played in a team game against Vasa, I think, was it last week? Anyway, he played the strongest player from Africa, Bassem Amin, on the first board. Of course, extremely strong grandmaster, 26-70 on the ELO, and he played this b6, and he just got a fine position out of the opening, and he accepted a draw in a winning position, even though it was for the team, of course, but it turned out that we lost the team match anyway. But there's nothing wrong with this opening. I'm not really sure if knight c3, knight f3 is supposed to be the critical stuff anyway. I would have figured bishop d3 and then knight f3 and maybe queen e2, knight d2 is something that most white players go for, but I know he plays something like e6, d5 and he gets some kind of French defense. And he has good results with it. Anyway, knight f3, and the problem with playing knight c3 early is, of course, that bishop b4 is always, you have to watch out for bishop f4, bishop b4, sorry. Bishop d3, knight f6, black is just developing his pieces. There's nothing really wrong with this position, but anyway, we see here that white has a very aggressive idea in mind. He plays e5 here, which of course isn't that... it's not ideal. You don't want to move those pawns unless you really have to, but after knight e4, he plays this move castling, which I kind of like. I kind of like the ambition. I really like those moves, just sacrificing a pawn, just trying to get the center. But we have to look at it in a critical sense. He's sacrificing a pawn, and let's see, if you take on c3, b takes c3, bishop takes c3, and I guess you have to play rook b1. This position looks quite alright for white, actually. I mean, this bishop on d3 is really strong. You can't really castle because of knight bishop takes h7 ideas, you know. This is the well-known Greek gift, and of course, at this point, maybe even queen d3 and take back the piece, but of course, they always... This is the typical plan, and black kind of gets mated here. You have to watch out for those. And so if you can't castle, let's say you play h6, his bishop on c3 is not really doing much. It has to go back to a5 later, I guess, and it's not very well placed. You can play rook b3 immediately if you want to. Later on, white will just play queen e2, rook b3, and just try to build up some kind of attack. And black has an extra pawn, but it doesn't really make itself felt. It, This looks kind of good for white, I have to admit, even though Erik Blomqvist would probably not agree. I usually tease Erik because he's probably the greediest player I know. He always accepts pawns or two pawns. He will do anything for a pawn. Anyway, that's what it takes with the bishop on c3 instead, and he probably has an interesting idea behind it because b takes c3, knight takes c3, and the queen has to move. Queen e1 is played. Maybe queen d2 was an interesting option as well. Perhaps trying to get the queen to f4 or something. Not really sure. Could be better. Could be worse. You see queen e1. And it takes on f3. So at least he manages to kind of destroy the pawn structure. But I mean, g takes f3, knight d5, c4, knight d7. I would still be quite afraid here with black. He's a pawn up. But white has the bishop pair. And some... It feels like white's position is easier to play. He's a pawn down, but the position is quite free. I guess black will play something like knight c6 and try to develop, but it looks kind of dangerous. I mean, okay, let's just make a couple of moves. Knight c6 attacking the pawn on d4, and if I guess white has to defend somehow, let's just say bishop b2. And if black plays knight f5, you have to watch out for moves like d5 or take and followed by d5. Probably black has some ideas with knight e4 at some point, but anyway, it's white to move here. I played queen e4 actually, which looks fine as well. You have to protect the rook on a8. I don't really like Westerberg's position, and yeah, looking at the times, this is very typical for Westerberg. He plays his own openings. He knows them extremely well. Usually, at least. Maybe not this time, but he knows them really well. He never gets into time trouble. He has very good time here, and white has been thinking a lot. He is already down on 30 minutes. And that reminds me, I gotta check out what's the time limit in this game. I'm not really sure what the time control is, but I will look that up. I promise. Anyway, I would be afraid with black's pieces, but I'm always the aggressive type, so... That's, maybe it's just me. Anyway, let's say knight c6 in this position. And if d5, we have to look how dangerous is this really. Let's say knight b4 trying to get this bishop. Maybe it's not that horrible. At all. I mean, this pawn on d5, you have to do something. If d6, just take it, I guess. Black is not really getting mated here. Looks alright. And I mean, if you get the bishop on d3, then that's white's bishop pair going away. And I mean, something like this would be horrible for white. If you get the knight to f5, this is definitely something to avoid. This would be really good for black, of course. So yeah, maybe it's not that easy for white to get his compensation, but it feels like, yeah, the position should be fine. Something like knight c6, maybe king h1, followed by rook g1. Looks like... interesting, at least. Maybe... I think Westerberg is not too unhappy with this position anyway, but... yeah, it looks interesting. Anyway, I think we'll take a short break just to see that the technology is working alright. Okay, I'll be back in a minute. Okay, I think I'm back. I'm handling the t technology by myself this time, so I'm not really sure everything's going perfectly, but hopefully it's working all right. Well, the feedback is that everything works all right, so hopefully it is. Let's look at Felix Tuominen, and he's one of my closest friends, and he's playing against Ulvi Bajarani. And Felix has been playing really well for the last couple of months. He had a fantastic Wilton Cup, but I usually tease him because he gets more results than he usually deserves to have. And yeah, he doesn't really know much about chess, but he's really good at playing it. If you ask him about any position or famous game or theoretical position, he has absolutely no clue, but it's always interesting to see him play. And here he's playing Ulvi Bajarani, who I'm pretty sure he's a grandmaster as well. I'm not really sure where he's from. I'm gonna say Azerbaijan. That was just a wild guess, but anyway, Felix doesn't really know too much theory, and we see here that he's playing a Catalan. I'm pretty sure he's out of the book already here after 4 moves. This has been played a couple of thousand times, but anyway, he plays bishop e7, castling, castling, queen c2. This has been played thousands of times, and here we see that Felix is not really the theoretician kind of guy. He plays c6, which is really not really the move you want to play. He has some experience in the Semislav, which is of course why he plays c6, but I mean, those who knows the variation would play a6 here, definitely. And we would get this kind of position, queen c2, bishop b7. This has been played so many times back. Usually wants to play knight d7 and play c5. And white has a couple of ideas trying to avoid it, like bishop d2, bishop a5 is one idea, putting the rook on d1. Ulf Andersson, I think, used to play this move, bishop g5, and take on f6, just so the knight isn't on d7. Anyway, c6, this is kind of the problem for Felix. He doesn't know many of the subtleties of the variations, which is kind of, I kind of like that about him, but anyway, this could leave him in trouble in quite a lot of positions. And here we see that black, of course, needs to play c5 at some point, and playing c6 is not the way you want to play c5. You want this pawn on a6 and the pawn on c5, not the other way around. Here we see knight d2 is played, knight d7, knight b3. White is playing very well here, I think, preventing c5, and this is also, maybe some players would play something like knight c3 here, but I'm not really sure that's better, because, well, this idea with knight d2, knight b3 would just be more to the point, preventing c5 forever. And we see that Felix, he has this kind of solid position. He gets his position kind of developed, but white is of course better. Knight e1, knight is going to d3, and well, if it gets to d3, you can forget about playing c5 for this game at least. But yeah, Felix plays well. He plays e5, and I kind of like this, even though it's not really solving too many problems. It's I think it's good to play this move e5 while you have the chance, because if the knight gets to d3, this game can quickly go horribly, horribly wrong. And I mean, something like knight d3, bishop e3, or even bishop d2, bishop a5, I don't like it at all. e5, d takes e5, knight takes bishop e3. So black isn't going to be able to play c5 in this game, and bishop c5. The thing about Felix is that he usually gets this kind of position out of the opening. I mean, this is not really worse than what he usually gets out of the opening, but anyway, he's extremely good at fighting. And if the white player would slip up at some point, I think Felix is extremely good at taking his chances, which is kind of his specialty, I guess. Taking on e7, knight a5. I mean, I think strategically this position is close to losing for black, because if you don't get to play this move c5, then this bishop is horrible, and yeah, this is horrible strategically. But it's kind of, yeah, Felix just needs one chance in this game. He just needs white to slip up at some point, and even grandmasters do it. And yeah, knight f3. Knight takes, bishop a8, and that bishop is, he's a piece down. What is it? Yeah, I mean, this is not a beautiful position. I'm probably going to tease him a bit about playing this way in the later on, but But yeah, this is kind of what he gets all the time. I mean, I'm not really surprised anymore. Rook a c1, everything is still extremely natural. Knight b3 just keeps preventing everything. a3, queen e7. What is this bishop doing on a8? White is basically a piece up. He can play knight c5 at any time. I mean, something like this would be maybe not the best idea right now, but why not? I mean, the rook c1 is going to win something on c6 at least, and then. Yeah, I mean, black should be happy if it just loses one pawn in this game. But anyway, yeah, I can't really see too many chances for Felix in this game, but I never do, so he always surprises me with his results. And I always tease him about it. So, he doesn't really. It's not really. I kind of feel like I'm being mean at some point, but he's not really. He knows it himself that he's the kind of player who gets his chances one time and he just has to take it one time. But against grandmasters, you don't really always get those chances. And you could look at his game from Wilton. It's not really. He had extremely good results, but the games weren't that pretty. I know Felix extremely well, which is why I can criticize him. Anyway, Erik Törn is of course another one of my good friends. He's the team captain in my team, so I have to speak well of him, otherwise he will give me all blacks. And I don't want to play black. Anyway, he plays a lot of different openings, usually d4 and knight f3 or something like that, but anyway, he just wants to develop, and I think he has played Mads Svensson before. I think Mads is a strong international master from Denmark, who I think scored all of his international norms last summer within like 1 month or something, which is really impressive. And, well, we have this symmetrical English variation, I guess, which is. This e6 knight, e7 stuff is really supposed to be extremely solid for black. I never really liked it because it can lead to some kind of positions like this and d5. Okay, I'm not really sure exactly how, but yeah, it can lead to quite dry play. Something like this has been played a couple of times. I've had this position at some point, and it's extremely dry. Good luck trying to win this. Anyway, a3, it looks like I like Turn spirit. He's trying to play for a win. a3, rook b1. I'm not really sure about the theory anymore. I played something with d3 and knight e7, bishop g5. I think this is what Marvin recommends in his book, but I don't really remember this stuff. Bishop d2. I played it once, maybe 3 or 4 years ago. It's supposed to be fine for black, but I think pretty much everything is supposed to be fine for black if you check carefully enough. Rook b1, d5, and c takes, e takes, d3. I'm not really extremely thrilled about the position, but I guess white has to do really wicked stuff to be seriously worse, but yeah, it feels like he has to play for something like bishop d2 and play for b4, but this doesn't strike me as too critical. h6 was played because I guess maybe bishop d5 was kind of annoying, but no, I don't really see why you would have to go h6 here. Maybe he just wants to go bishop e6 and not be annoyed with knight g5 stuff. Could be. Bishop f4. Bishop e6. It looks like a position. Knight a4. Okay, this is interesting. White kind of forces black to play b6, and after b6 he can go b4 immediately. We couldn't go b4 immediately here because of the knight on c3. b4, and, well, the critical stuff. Let's see, if we take on b4 here, how is this? Doesn't strike me as extremely dangerous for black either. Something like knight f5, maybe b5, knight d4. It looks alright for black, but probably white is alright here as well. We see white. He plays c4. And takes, takes, and b5. We have to figure out if this pawn on c4 is weak or strong. But I don't know. Knight a5. This is extremely interesting, actually. Not really sure who's better or who's worse. And that's kind of the problem not having another commentator here, but I'll try and do my best. It feels like white might be doing alright here. Pawn doesn't look that strong anyway. And I like this move, bishop e5, that Eric plays, because if you get rid of the bishop on g7, this knight on c3 is just a good piece, I guess, and this pawn is much less dangerous. And this bishop on g2 is quite good as well. We can use the square on c6 later on. It feels like white is doing alright here, bishop e5. Not really sure if it's better, but I feel like his position is quite interesting. Knight takes e5, rook c8, knight c3. Like I said, he gets the square on c3. The pawn on c4 isn't that dangerous. But on the other hand, what can white attack? You can try to use the c6 square somehow. It doesn't feel like... Maybe white is slightly better or slightly worse. I'm not sure. Knight f3. It feels alright for both players. King h7. White can of course play... Black can of course play a knight b3 at some point, but not really, really sure how much it leads to. If you just move the queen to... Maybe c2. If you go to e3, maybe knight f5 would be annoying at some point. Queen f4. Not really sure a queen trade is what you want with white. Okay, maybe it's not. Okay, I have no idea who's better, actually. I have no idea. Ooh, this is interesting. We have a game. This is extremely interesting. We have the two extremely young Norwegian players, Tor Fredrik Karlsen, who is kind of one of the biggest subjects of talking chess Norway today, but I think he's 14 years old as well, and he has been playing really well this last couple of months. He has, I think he's like 2470, but I'm not really gonna discuss how he got that rating. I'm not really sure how to judge his play, because his results are really strange. So he played in Kroger last week, I think. It was a strong tournament in Norway. And in the first game he actually was completely losing with white after 14 moves. I think it was forced mate, because the king was on f4 after 14 moves against a 1900 player, which is not really common for a 2470 player. But somehow his opponent didn't see the mate, he blundered everything, he lost the game. Karlsen won that game quite amazingly, and he went on to play a very good tournament. He even scored an international master mode, so I'm not really sure what to say about this play. But in the tournament before that, in I think Austria, he played not really 2400 level, playing 21 performance perhaps. So he's one of the players who can play extremely well when he's in the right mood, I guess, and if he's not in the right mood, he can play extremely bad. So yeah, let's see if he's in the shape. I mean, I think he becomes an international master if he scores his final norm. He scored one norm in Kroger last weekend, and he scored one in, I think, Oslo a couple of months ago. And he's playing Evin Rifting from Norway, who I know quite a lot about, because he's an interesting person, at least, you can say that. Anyway, we see that we have the Karokan. And Karlsen doesn't really play the main lines here. I mean, e5 is usually what everyone plays these days. If you want to know the theory, look it up, because I don't know it very well. I mean, bishop f5, this is what everyone plays. I don't know it at all. I usually play something like h4 here. Or you could always use the old main lines with knight c3, knight d2, and we get this kind of position. But I think black is doing alright here, theoretically. Anyway, it seems like Karlsen is not having a theoretical discussion against the Risting. He just takes on d5, bishop d3, knight c6, c3. So it looks like he just wants to develop his pieces, and yeah. I mean, this move order is kind of important, because bishop d3, you kind of prevent black from playing bishop f5. This is kind of annoying for black. You don't have anywhere to go with this bishop. You want to play something like bishop f5, e6, knight e7 at some point. Bishop d6, of course, first. But also, white is kind of waiting with the move knight f3, because then we would have the square on g4 for the bishop. And after c3, black usually these days plays queen c7, which it's kind of the same idea. White doesn't want to go to f4. He wants to go to f4 with the bishop, but he isn't allowed to. h3, and I have to remember this stuff. I think that if white plays knight e2, trying to insist on playing bishop f4, there's some ideas going bishop g4, and then bishop d7. And if you play bishop f4, you can go e5. And this move f3 is not very nice to have played. D takes, knight takes, and then the bishop can come to c5. This is quite decent for black. You can just look it up, and I think it's in Schandorf's books or in Huska. It's pretty much everywhere. Anyway, he plays h3 here, which is a sign that he wants to play knight f3 without having bishop g4. And Risting plays e6, which doesn't strike me as the most critical move. But of course, it's hard to go extremely wrong for black. I would probably play something like g6, and maybe play bishop f5, because this structure is not that bad for black. You can play e6, knight f6, nothing too special. The king isn't going to be weak anyway. I think this is quite alright for black. Anyway, e6 is played. Knight f3, bishop d6. The structure would probably be some kind of Karlsbad structure. For those of you who play the Queen's Gambit, you can look it up. This is the structure you usually get. Not this move order, of course, but this structure is the similar one you get here, but with reversed colors. And it feels like white has quite a decent version. The bishop on d3 is very nice. And the problem, I think, is that black would usually want to go b5, b4 and start his minority attack on the queen side. It's not that easy to accomplish here. White would probably try to castle rook e1, maybe try to prepare the knight e5. But yeah, it's going. Yeah, let's see what happens. Castling h6, rook e1, knight f6. So they just develop the pieces. Castling, queen e2. This can be reached from a lot of different openings, I guess. Even a collar, I guess. But anyway, Risting starts an own interesting idea. He plays knight h5. And it's no. I kind of like this move. It's going to. It's no secret. This knight is going to f4. And let's see, if you play knight f1, why not knight f4 anyway? I guess you don't want to get rid of this bishop, it's so nice on d3, so if you take here. I don't really see what white would have for the bishop pair. I mean, I don't think it's nothing too special. The knights aren't bad in this position, but yeah, it feels quite alright for black. He has the bishop pair, why not? White could perhaps play knight h2, knight g4 maybe. It's nothing critical, but yeah, anyway, g3 was played, and here the fun starts, because Risting just takes it. Bishop takes g3, and if this works, the game is basically over for white. And we see here, queen takes g3, and we have to look what happens here. Obviously, you can't play queen g2 here, because you can just take it. And we play knight f4, and the bishop on d3 drops off, and black is just 2 pawns up. You can't play that. So you play king h1. Knight f4 is played anyway, threatening here. Well, there's always a mate on g2 threatening the pawn on h3. This looks kind of dangerous. Queen f1, e5. And this is kind of what I was talking about. Risting is a extremely strong player, but it looks like he's just losing here. Bishop takes h3 is about to be played. Okay, I'm just gonna skip through the moves here. He played knight e4, which is of course extremely desperate. Takes on e4, takes on f4. And yeah, black is just winning. I'm just gonna go through the moves. He's 2 pawns up. Which is of course quite enough to win this game. and he loses immediately. Queen h2. The game is already over. Risting has won. Carlsen has resigned. What can you say? Carlsen is a 24 player. Risting is. I can't really say how good Risting is because his results are extremely. Well, what can you say? His results aren't always accurate as well, because a couple of years ago, I think maybe 2 years ago, he was a 1900 player, and suddenly he scored an international master norm, and he was up to 2400. Then he was back down to 1900. I don't know what these Norwegian kids are drinking these days. Something really weird. And knowing Risting, I mean, he's... I don't know what he has been drinking anyway. Anyway, he scored a pretty good game today, but let's face it, Carlsen just blundered. This g3 was probably just horrible. And this is probably the problem with that Carlsen has. He's going to play some kind of Grand Prix for juniors soon, which is basically all the strongest juniors in I think Europe or the world. I'm not really sure, but anyway, he's going to be playing against 2500 in a Grand Prix, and he has to play much better than he has been playing here. It seems like, I don't know if he's is a slow starter, because he played very badly in Kroger as well, but yeah, this is not really a good game. I know he knows Risting extremely well as well. I think they're good friends, and it's always tough to lose against a friend because they're no longer your friend. No, I'm just kidding, but yeah, it's more prestige when you play against someone you know well. Okay, let's look at the other games. This did not go well for the favorite, rating favorite at least. Carlsen has to play better than this, and well, scoring his final international master norm is going to be extremely tough when he loses like this with white. Yeah, let's see what's going on. I'm just gonna look this game. This is exactly what I was talking about. I'm so afraid of these kids just knowing the theory and the Alapin and just. And this looks like he's just going to achieve a draw. It's a rookie endgame with equal pawns. And I'm. Of course, Tokayo is going to play this for a win. He can play rook a5 and try to play against his pawn on e5, but I really doubt he's going to be able to win this. I would be afraid that this will just be a draw, but yeah, of course, I don't think Black will achieve the draw so easily. He will fight for it, but I don't see him losing. Okay, what's happened here? Westerberg has an interesting position. Queen e4, knight c6. This is what I was talking about. D5, knight before. And if Black gets time to play, take on d3 here and put the knight on f5, of course, he's much better, which of course, it's not what Westerberg wants to allow. He played bishop g5, which looks really strong, actually. You can't really play f6 anytime soon, anyway, so he takes on d3, and he just ignores this, and he plays d6. So it's extremely, well, tactical now. He takes on d6, and this is the position we have now. This knight on d3. Can he go to c5? I have to check this. What's going on here? White could probably just take on. Could he take on e7? Probably. And of course, you can't take on e4 because we just take here and we're a piece up in the end. But okay, if we move the queen somewhere, we have to protect the rook on a8. So let's move it to queen c8. This pawn on e7 looks extremely strong, but at the same time, if Black has the time to go f6 and pick it up, then. Yeah, I'm not really. I have no idea what's going on here, actually. Queen h4. Can you play f6? We have to watch out for sacrifices and all kind of crazy ideas. But yeah, it feels like. It looks very aggressive, at least. I like this play of Rakesh, and it feels like this game could end quite soon. Ah, I actually played f6 immediately and just took an f6. Okay. What's going on? I have no idea. Let's take back. I'm not really sure what the idea is. I mean, if it takes on e7, queen takes d3, let's count the pawns. It feels like Black is a pawn up, and he has a better position, right? The king is absolutely safe. White's pawn structure is in ruins. Probably this is just very good for Westerberg. Maybe he was in control of all the time. Or he has something. Oh, okay. Sorry, apparently A8 is a blunder. But he can just take with the king, right? Yeah, this is still extremely safe for black. Not really sure what the problem is. Yeah, I don't like white's position anymore, and this is the problem with playing this attacking chess that I kind of like, but sometimes it just doesn't work out. And it seems like this position is nothing to be... Yeah, it just looks losing for white, actually. Or I'm missing something extremely simple like I did recently, but... Yeah, it looks like Westerberg will just win this game. With careful play, of course, but... Yeah, Queen c7, anything goes. It should be just much better for black. Okay, let's take a look at... Yeah, we're gonna take a look at Milton Panzer. He's one of the young Swedish guys we have in the tournament. I think he's 15 years old. He has a rating of 22-50 maybe. And he's one of the solid guys we have in Sweden right now, and he's quite young, quite talented. I think he's going to... He has applied for the NTG, Norsk Toppidrettsgymnas, which is kind of a school for talented chess players in Norway, and the Swedish guys go there sometimes as well. But anyway, he's talented. Lives in Stockholm, and his dad, Pontus Sjödahl, is of course a strong international master, so he has a good sparring partner, of course. And yeah, he plays e3. The thing about Milton is he plays the same openings over and over again. Knight e2. I've seen him play this so many times. And we see that Hambleton plays this move c6, which is very recent discovery. But I really like this move. And a couple of months ago, not even months, I think a couple of weeks ago, there was a tournament in Austria where Milton played, and he was playing there with a couple of Norwegian talents as well. And he played my friend Anton Danell, and I recommended Anton to play this variation with c6 against him. I think I looked at Jan Gustafsson's DVD on chess24. And yeah, apparently... Yeah, I mean, the critical stuff here is playing b4, bishop c7, e4. This leads to really sharp play. You can play both d6 and d5, but it's really sharp. I think black is doing quite alright here if he knows his stuff, but Hambleton, of course, is a strong international master from Canada. I think he knows this quite well. And Milton, opening wise, I think is kind of lazy. He plays the same stuff over and over. He doesn't really look up any improvements or anything. He just plays. And yeah, of course, he's very talented, but I also think that if he wants to be even better, you have to start working more about looking at the games and trying to... yeah, of course, nothing wrong with these openings, but... Yeah, I think I spoke to Anton a couple of minutes ago, and he said that they followed his game. I think this was the position they had in his game in Lyon's Open, I think it's called. Not really sure that Anton played bishop e5. But anyway, he got absolutely no problem. I think Anton was even better out of the opening against Milton, but he blundered later on, and he lost the game. But anyway, I mean, Milton has played this position before. I don't think he has absolutely no advantage at all. I think if anyone has to be careful, I think it's white. But this is kind of the problem for Milton. If he wants to be better, he has to analyze the games even better, I think. And at least not go for the same positions again and again, even though they may be not that good for him. Bishop e5 looks very natural as well. And yeah, I'm not sure if that game is in the database, and maybe black has prepared it. I don't think that game is in the database, but anyway, I'm sure that Anton is looking at this game as well and looking at me now, so hey Anton. Och anyway, we will see what's going on. D takes c6, and this is extremely interesting. Hambleton plays this extremely aggressive move, h5, and I really like this, because black has the bishop pair. It's really good. The bishops are pointing against the king. h4 is coming. these knights are kind of protecting themselves. They don't have any nice squares to go to, and you don't really want to take this pawn on b7, because look at those bishops now. Rook c8, f5, okay, maybe not f5 at some point, because the bishop on a2, but h4 is a huge threat, and this looks horrible. There's a mate on g2 in some variations. You're threatening to take on g3. You're threatening h4. I think this is one of those positions where something can go extremely wrong for white quickly. And Milton really wants a very solid position with a clear plan. He plays very cautious chess, and he doesn't like this chaos that I prefer. But Milton is a strong player, of course. He knows how to calculate. I don't think it's his cup of tea, this position, anyway. Let's look at... what do we have? We have another young Swedish player. We have Hampus Sörensen. He was kind of the reserve for this tournament. He doesn't really have 2200 in rating. He's like 2190 or something. But because we were 23 players, which is an odd number, we have to have an even number because we don't want any walkovers. He was allowed to play in the tournament. And he's playing this young player from Iceland, Vignir Vatnar Stefansson, who played this tournament last year. He played extremely well. And yeah, I'm not really sure how old Vignir Vatnar is, maybe 13 or 14 years old, and his rating is already like 2400, so yeah, there are a lot of young talents in this tournament. I think Vignir is... he's a really strong player, but a couple of weeks ago in the Nordic Championship, I saw a side of him that I have never seen before, because in the first three rounds he played extremely badly. I mean, I've seen him play, he can play extremely well, and yeah, he's a really good player, but that tournament, I don't know what happened. I'm not gonna ask anyway, but I mean, he played much, much worse than he usually does. Out of the first three games, I think he scored half a point against like 1700-1800 players, and he was even lucky to score that half a point. And he lost some games in 20 moves with black, and it just was horrible. Anyway, I think he won his final 33 games, but anyway, it wasn't a pretty sight. Here we placed the London, which is of course extremely popular nowadays. I don't think juniors should play the London. I think it's too boring and so on, but because Carlsen plays it, everyone plays it, and yeah, there's nothing wrong with the opening. And I kind of like the way Sörensen is playing this opening as well. I have to say that because I used to train Hampus, I was his coach, opening coach at least, for about a year, last year I think. No, it was 2 years ago, but his openings have really improved. Of course, thanks to me. No, I'm just kidding, but bishop h4. I'm trying to remember a game by Nils Grandelius, of course, the Swedish number one, and he played in the World Blitz Championship, I think, a couple of months ago in Qatar. He played this against, I can't really remember who, but he got an extremely comfortable position. Bishop e7, not really sure this is how the game went, but anyway, he got to play something like queen c2, f5. And his position out of the opening was just absolutely fantastic. This is probably what I would want to play with black as well. And it seems like Hampus is really booked up. I haven't looked at this position with him, of course, so he probably looked at this by himself. Queen c2, f5. I'm usually not a big Stonewall fan, but I think against the London, this is quite alright. I'm not really sure if bishop e7 is what you're supposed to play, but yeah, I'm not really sure if I like bishop e7. Anyway, let's see, queen c2, f5. There's nothing too wrong with black's position anyway, it's extremely solid. Yeah. Okay, so it's not really a fun position to play. I would have tried to keep a couple of more pieces on the board if I was playing black, but yeah, it feels like maybe white is a tiny bit better. but nothing special. I mean, usually white would have to do something with the pawns, but I mean, if you play c4, at some point that would be horrible strategically, because this bishop on b7 is so strong, and now it even, I think it loses material because of queen c6, but yeah, it feels like black is doing alright. c4 is not really an idea, e4 is not really an idea. You can't really open up the position with white without making this bishop really strong. It would have to be g4 at some point, but it looks very difficult to achieve right now. Queen c8. Okay, so apparently he wants to trade another pair of bishops. So queen e2, a5. It's not really... it's a not really subtle idea, but f3. I like the way Wigner plays this. e4. I'm not really sure if black should have gone for this queen c8, a5, trying to trade his bishop, because the bishop on d3 wasn't that much better than the bishop on b7, but yeah, this looks, it looks alright, even though this structure is probably a slightly better for white. Something like rook e1, at some point maybe queen h3, just putting pressure on these pawns. I'm not really happy about the way Hampus has played the last couple of moves. It looks like he's a bit worse, but nothing horrible. I mean, something rook a1, maybe you can take on f1 here. And the natural move would probably be rook takes, but then maybe you can take here and play queen d5. This looks alright. It should be a draw. But yeah, I think the game should be a draw, but black is the one who has to be careful for sure. Yeah, I'm not really sure. Why did he trade all those pieces? Maybe knight takes d2. I'm not really sure if he wants to play that immediately. I'm still not sure if he should play bishop e7 here or not. He could move the queen as well. Yeah. Anyway, if Hampus gets a point, that would be extremely good. He has been playing much better in the last couple of months. He is really one of the most talented players we have in Sweden, and I'm of course very happy when everything goes well for him. Mostly because I used to be his coach, so I can take some of the credit, even though it's, I probably ruined his career by learning him some bad openings. Anyway, let's look at what's going on in this rook endgame. H5, it feels like white is not really ambitious in this game. It feels like he's just trade some pieces and achieve a draw, which makes me kind of root for black. But yeah, I'm not really sure he's going anywhere in this game. I mean, white could at some point play b4. Not really sure that he wants to play b4, but if rook a2, you have rook g4. I mean, something like this, rook g4. Black would have to play f6 and the structure, and yeah, I don't think anyone's going to win this game. I think this will be a draw, which is of course a good result for Tryggestad, but I mean, looking at the game, not really ambitious, I have to say. Probably I want to see more action. Maybe white can even at some point play f4 when we have to get this structure. But this is more, there's more play in the structure than before, because now both have these passed pawns and they start running and tactics and stuff, so maybe black has some idea to trick white here. Maybe you can check and play rook g3 even. That would be quite annoying. Yeah. So maybe not f4. That's probably a bad idea. Anyway, I don't think, if white doesn't do anything really bad in this game, I think it will end in a draw. Even though Tokayev is a strong player, he's playing black, and white played a very dull variation. He didn't get anything out of the opening, but yeah. Okay, let's see what's going on. Is there anything horrible going on? Oh, I have to look at Filip Lindgren, because, well, he stays in my apartment, or my family's apartment during this tournament. And yeah, he plays the King's Indian. Well, his opponent plays the King's Indian. I think he's a young player from Mongolia who I think lives in New York now. But anyway, Lindgren plays this Mislav variation, which I kind of like. I actually showed this version to him, I think, in 2012, and he's been playing it ever since. This is what I do. I mention bad variations to people, and they play it, and then I win against them. No, I'm kidding. It's nothing wrong with this Mistlove. I'm not too familiar with this e6 immediately. I've seen some game by Luke McShane in this variation. I think White has been doing extremely well in practice, but I think the critical stuff would be something like h6, going for this bishop with knight h5, and there has been a lot of games in this variation by, for example, Yevgeny August. He usually plays this, and on the black side there's usually like Emanuel Berg or Tigran Hilla-Persson. So yeah, I think theoretically black is doing absolutely all right, but yeah, it's an interesting position. I've played it a couple of times, because I think the structure, like knight e2, I think this is interesting structure. You can play for f4 ideas and even g4. There's a lot of play. But after e6, I think knight e2, yeah, I think I've seen Philip play this before. And basically if you take on d5, you get this real nice square on c4 for the knight. h6, bishop h4, and we get this. I think it's just a good kind of Benoni for white. But on the other hand, most Benonis are good for white, so yeah, it just looks like a normal game, a knight e5. And the problem, usually the pawn is not on e3 in a Benoni, it's on e4, but I think it's probably even better on e3, because on e4 it just leads to some tactical problems later on. I mean, it's a pawn that black usually tries to attack somehow with the, well, with the rook on e8, knight on f6. Sometimes you can play b5 because the pawn is on e4. And here we see another idea that Philip actually plays, queen c7. He plays f4, knight e7, and he plays e4. So he's slowly building up here in the center, and later on he was going to play e5, which is the main idea. He could even play for g4, g5 at some point, but yeah, some typical idea would be something like this: f5, and then knight e4, take on g6, with some strong attack. Maybe not here, because maybe black can even go e4, but yeah, he's going to play slowly. He wants to play knight c4 and just improve the position. Queen c2, rook e1, and later on he wants to push e5. For sure. Bishop g3 is always another move. So this move c4, I like it, even though I'm not sure if it works so good here. But I like that black realizes the position is dangerous and he's trying to change it. So, well, he's opening up this diagonal, which is kind of important if he wants to grab this pawn, but I wouldn't be so greedy. I would rather enjoy the square on c5 with the knight, which is kind of what happened in the game. Knight c5, so he's pushing on this pawn on e4, and yeah, Philip just takes bishop takes c4, so white is a pawn up, and black needs to show some kind of compensation. Philip is kind of he's playing kind of like Blomqvist. He's kind of greedy. He likes taking pawns. But there's nothing wrong with taking pawns. If it's just a pawn and black has no compensation, then white is probably just much better here. But what does he have? He can't really take on e4, right? It doesn't work out tactically. No, I'm not really sure what's going on. Probably. Oh, looking at the time, black is just down on 10 minutes. I have no idea. Do they get more time after 40 moves? I would hope so for black, but yeah, I don't know. I don't really like this. C4 is a nice idea, but if it's just a pawn, then it's a pawn. No, this looks good for white. And of course, I'm gonna take credit for this because I showed Philip this variation. No, I'm not. Okay, let's see what's going on. Has anything happened? Ooh, Blomqvist. We haven't seen Blomqvist play in a while. Hello played this move queen g4, which looked kind of strange to me, but who am I to question Mihailov's moves. Queen takes h3, knight g5. We left somewhere around here. King g2 looks extremely natural as well. Just save things in squares. Now queen h3 isn't possible anymore, for example. Knight e8. So probably the knight might be heading to c7 and he wants to play b5 later on, but e4. He plays this move e5. Now we have to start thinking. What is it doing? I mean, the bishop on g7 obviously doesn't like a move like e5, but at the same time the bishop on b2 isn't doing much anyway, so probably if white doesn't do anything, black will just eventually play f5 and maybe take on e4, maybe play f4, and white at the same time doesn't really have any way to open up the queen side, because b4 is not really on the cards. This would probably be very good for black if you just let it be. So we take on e6 instead, which is what Blomqvist did. It has to be correct. F takes e6. And he plays knight back to g1. How would you explain this move? Well, basically, first of all, the knight is hanging. That's extremely deep. But it's important, and I guess knight g1. The knight would be better on e2, I guess, because the knight on f3 doesn't really cooperate with the rest of the king side, and if he's allowed to, the knight could even go to f4. This would be a dream square for the knight, because the queen is hanging, the pawn on e6 is weak, and you can't really play e5 later, because, well, chess, knight e5, that would be terrible. So Mihailov plays g5, which I kind of like as well. The knight isn't going to f4 anytime soon. Rook a1, knight e5, and I guess if black gets to play g4, which kind of makes sure that this knight on e5 isn't going away anytime soon, I think black would be doing very well. But Erik doesn't want that to happen, so he plays f4, and this is where the game turns extremely interesting. He takes an f4, knight g6. It feels like these pawns on f4 and e4, they can become weak, and we don't really need to play moves like f5 and leave the squares on e5. But at the same time, I don't know, this king doesn't look that weak anyway. King h1 he played, it looks safe enough. Queen g4, and he plays f5 anyway. And he takes on f5. What's going on here? It's at least an extremely interesting position, but just looking at the pieces, I'm not really sure what the knight on e8 is doing here. And at some point, you have to watch out for queen d5. I don't think this pawn on b7 is very important, but I know Blomqvist, and he's going to take that pawn on b7. He just loves those pawns. But, okay, let's say queen d5 check. And probably king, I don't know, king h7. Take on f5, perhaps. I guess knight e5. And I don't know, why not take on b7? Knight f6. I think white is doing quite well, but black has some really active pieces. Nah, I think this should be good for white. I'm just scared that this king will be weak somehow, but I mean, white could always just play something like, I don't know, queen g2. Nah, this has to be good for white. And Erik is a pawn up. There's nothing wrong with being a pawn up. He took an f5 immediately. What happens if you take on f5 here? Feels like something tactical is going down. This actually happened in the game. So we took here. So, can you play something like knight d5? Yeah, he played knight d5. They're playing quite quickly now, but they have time. Okay, so let's take a look at this position. Strategically, white is winning, and probably tactically as well. This doesn't look good at all. I mean, this king is extremely weak. And I don't know how to develop this knight. I mean, it can't go here, it can't go here. Knight g7 looks horrible. Yeah, I also have to watch out for this check. No, I don't like this at all. It looks like Blomqvist is doing very well here. Oh wait, he's actually a pawn down. If Erik Blomqvist a pawn down, I also. But still, I mean, Erik is the type of player who knows that he's a pawn down and he knows that it doesn't really matter for the position, but somehow it feels like it bothers him that he's a pawn down. I mean, he's by far the most greedy person I know, at least on the chessboard. He's not really greedy otherwise, but yeah, he likes pawns. So yeah, probably he's doing really well here anyway, even though he's a pawn down, but yeah. Let's look at Theodor. We can just look quickly. I mean, we saw this position. I wasn't very thrilled about it, but let's see. He took on b3. I don't like this. But okay, he got rid of the bishop pair. Queen f3. So apparently you have to defend this guy. Queen e6, rook c7. I mean, looking at the pieces, I don't like this. I mean, how are you going to stop bishop c4? This looks... I almost want to resign this game. I'm probably being a bit dramatic, but at least white is going to pick up this pawn, and I don't see this pawn is going to fall, and white... No, I don't see... Black is going to lose this for sure. Unfortunately for my friend Theodor, this doesn't look good. No, I don't like this at all. Let's look at some of the other guys. I'm gonna look at Felix's position. They're always kind of... Oh, sorry, I'm gonna update for a while. Let's look at this. Wow. This looks horrible. Sorry. What is this guy doing? Yeah, I'm gonna criticize him for this after the game for sure. It's always easier to be a commentator. You can just sit there and say that white is better, black is better, and if I'm wrong, nothing happens. So it's much worse for the players. Erik's position is still don't know what's going on. I feel like black is doing all right, but yeah, I like this bishop on f3 as well. It keeps the king safe, but this pawn on c4, it's not weak, it's not strong. I think it's more strong than weak, but yeah, I mean, you have to watch out for maybe this idea, trying to loosen up. But I mean, it's a position. I think it's I don't think anyone's clearly better. Let's look what's happening. We haven't really looked at. I'm just gonna go through it once again. Coulson actually lost his game quite horribly against Wisting. It's not much to say about the game. He just blundered. Okay, we have another result. We have another draw. Why did I say another draw? It's a first draw. Trygistol play against Tukayev, and he didn't even try to win this. It's just a draw. Which, once again, is why I don't play the Sicilian. I don't like this move c3 for black. I mean, maybe you have to play something more... if you really want to play for a win for black, maybe you have to go for something like this, which is, of course, leads to decent winning chances, but theoretically I'm not sure that black is doing alright here. Also, maybe this move order with knight f3 is even better. Yeah, another draw. Quite boring game. It's not going to be the game of the tournament, unfortunately, but I guess Trygistol has to be satisfied with a draw against one of the top players. Yeah. What else do we have? Westerberg, he's a pawn up, he has a better structure. White is trying rook h3, trying to create some kind of holes in black's position, but yeah, I don't really see him winning this game. Some tricks like rook g7 doesn't really work out because you can take on h7, I guess, but yeah, h6 like Westerberg played, it's just solid. Queen e3, maybe black can play something like... You can even take on c4 here. No, I think Westerberg is going to... He has better time, he has better position, he's going to win this game, I think. So yeah, what else is going on? Felix, yeah, he's going to lose. Still, this is not the worst position I've seen him play, but yeah, I don't see really how he's supposed to trick his opponent in this kind of position. He doesn't have any counterplay. He doesn't have any tactical tricks. He doesn't have a bishop. That's not a bishop. That's horrible. Yeah, I mean, it's a good game by Bajrani, but it feels like Felix didn't really put up any good resistance here. Milton's game, what's going on? What's going on? I have no idea. Let's look what happened. D5 bishop e5 knight c4. We left off the h5 rook d1. He just went h4, and Milton responded by f4. Which is probably the idea behind rook d1, because now black doesn't have this check on d4. And so everything is on fire, and black just plays this move bishop g4. And usually when you're a commentator and you don't know what's going on, you can just say something like black is better or white is better, and no one really knows why, but this time I have to say I have absolutely no idea what's going on. Everything is just hanging. My brain is completely freezing. I have no idea what's going on. Looking at the times, black has been thinking for quite a while, and I mean Milton. Okay, Milton played the first 16 moves the same as he played a couple of weeks ago. So he's probably in some kind of preparation, but I mean it's not a good variation for white really. Now this is exciting. I definitely want to see one of the players in here after the game, but I have absolutely no idea what's going on. I mean, this is hanging, this is hanging, this is hanging, this is hanging, this is hanging. What is going on? Let's just take a couple of pieces. Take on e5, then black is going to take on d1. Something like this. Take here. Take back, and let's count the pieces. Black is up an exchange, right? Okay, let's not take it on g3. Can we take here and try to get some kind of compensation? No. Probably not. This is not enough. Okay, so we can probably not take on e5. Let's just move the rook somewhere. So we want to keep black from checking here. So let's play rook d2. But if you take on h3, take here. What is going on? I don't know what's going on here. Either take on h2 maybe. This is the kind of position you have to calculate during the game. It's too difficult for me to see what's going on. Basically, I'm just too weak. Take on e5 maybe. Take on b7. Suddenly this looks... I don't even know how to evaluate these positions. Yeah, okay, let's see what's going on. I'm gonna switch the games because I'm too embarrassed to say that I don't understand the position. Let's look at... Okay, nothing has happened in Blomqvist's game. Theodore is probably... He played the move... okay. Bishop d8. I don't know if he should probably consider resigning quite soon. White could play bishop c4. And I don't really see what he's supposed to do. He has to sacrifice the queen somehow, right? But I mean b7 is saying this is horrible. It's losing. Why is he? I don't understand this. Is this just to not resign? I mean, looking at the time, he's on 7 minutes, and Majorov has been playing extremely well, and he's on 40 minutes. No, I don't get this at all. No, Kaniskog is going to lose, for sure. Unfortunately. Westerberg is still looking good. F5. I don't know, Queen C5. Even Queen C6, maybe. But Yeah, I mean, black is just going to improve the position slowly, and white is going to suffocate, for sure. Felix is probably going to lose as well, because he's a... Sorry, I'm gonna update. Is something wrong with the program that way? Because sometimes when you make marks, you have to delete them afterwards. I'm not sure how to do it. Queen e5. No, this bishop. I don't want to look at this position. Let's look at Erik Thörn's game. He's playing against Mads Hansen, and the same kind of position is going on there with queen b4, knight f5. I'm not really sure whether any player is trying to attack here, but it feels like... Okay, maybe white has some ideas with bishop d5, but I mean, he doesn't threaten much. I mean, king g7. White does not really want to play e4, at least. This is not really the strategical solution, because knight d4... Now, this is horrible. You can't play e4. Maybe you can play e3 at some point, but I would also be careful, because rook d3 at some point. You just want to keep everything the way it is, and I think... Maybe black can try h5 at some point. This is one of the most interesting games, actually, strategically, because I don't think there's an easy plan for either side here. The position is kind of blocked. I'm not really sure how anyone's going to win it, but yeah. Let's look at what's going on. Okay. Let's look at Philip Lindgren, because after bishop takes c4, basically if there's no tactics working for black, then white is just a pawn up. But he took on e4, which means something does, maybe it just works out. So he takes back, he plays bishop f5, rook e1, rook c8. This is very interesting, because he appears to regain a piece here on c4. And I mean, you can't move the bishop, because the queen on c2 is hanging. If you play b3, I guess b5? I mean, it still feels like white should be better. I'm definitely sure white should be better somehow, but... Because even if it's a piece down, I mean, he's already up a piece, so... I mean, g4 doesn't really... Is it g4? It doesn't really strike me as the right move, but... You could play something like this, and you mean... It's still a pawn up, right? Even though I'm not really sure if you're going to win this position, white is a pawn up. White is better for sure. I'm not really sure if he's going to win the game, but looking at the times, black is not doing too good either. Yeah, okay. Like I said, Kenneth Skoog. Yeah, he just gave his queen bishop b6, and this is horrible. I expect him to resign quite soon. What is the easiest way to win this position? I don't know, maybe just h4, h5. And if pawn gets to h6, then black is mated, and otherwise you can take here, but then the king is just weak. King d2, rook h1. White has to win this very soon. This looks horrible. Yeah, I actually think we're gonna take a small break. I'll be back in about 10 minutes, and yeah, keep looking at the games. I'll be back soon. Okay, I think I'm back. I'm gonna keep looking at the games for a while, of course. Blomqvist, still nothing much has happened. Maybe I should update the position to see what's going on. He's a pawn down, but he has really good compensation. I think the position might be easier to play with white also, because black is kind of passive. The knight on e8, the rook on a8. Of course, on second board we have this draw between Trugestad and Tokayev. Not really much going on in that game, kind of. Yeah, we want to see some more fighting games. And on third board we have Kaniskog who played this. Okay, he's gonna resign any time. I don't really see why I keep coming back to this game, because it's just over. I had some interesting comments during the break that suddenly Milton was winning. Maybe he was winning all the time. I didn't understand anything about this game. H4, F4, Bishop G4, Rook D2. I mean, my friend said that Milton was winning. I have to see what's going on. H takes G3, F takes E5. Okay, how do I navigate this position? I should probably. I know we have some kind of engine going on up here, but I'm not sure if it always is working all right, so I usually don't look at it. Maybe I should look at it more, but anyway, what's going on? If you take on h2, king takes h2. You could play king h1 as well, but anyway, let's take here. And I guess black is going to take on c6, perhaps. I mean, this pawn on f7 is okay. There might be some tactics with knight f6, and if you take, have queen takes g6, that would be not so good. And I mean, okay, can you play king h8? This looks horrible. I'm not really sure how you win it, but it looks horrible. So maybe my friends were just seeing much more than I did. Maybe Milton is just winning. Maybe king h1 is even better just to prevent the checks. Yeah, I mean, the position is extremely complicated. I have no idea what's going on, I have to admit, but okay, moves like bishop f5 obviously doesn't work. I'm not gonna say obviously, because nothing is obvious for me, but taking on f5 appears to work. Knight f6 and you win the queen, right? I think. What else is going on? I mean, Hambleton is down on less than 5 minutes. It has to be a good sign for Milton. And if Milton wins this game, I mean, that would be extremely good for him. He's a very strong player, but beating this international masters, and I think Hambleton, he has been above 2500. He's playing for Grandmaster norms, for sure. And he has been playing. I'm pretty sure he's from Canada. And I've seen him comment on Chessbro, I think they're called, with Erik Hansen and Robin van Kampen. I don't look at Twitch and whatever they're called too much, but I know that they're funny guys and I like their commentary. We see here that Blomqvist is using one other tactical trick. After bishop takes b2, queen takes. He found this move, knight g7, but after rook e7, it's a pretty move, threatening mate, and you can't really take it because of a fork winning the queen. So we have to defend it somehow. And this just looks good for white, I think. Knight h5 looks extremely risky, but can you play this way? Maybe you can just take a pawn on b7 or something. Guess this check, I'm not really sure if it leads to much, but queen g2. Even this endgame should be better for white, because black has some weakness on a6 and d6, so yeah. No, I think Blomqvist is doing quite well. It feels like maybe it's not horrible, but it's definitely easier to play white's position. And black is a bit behind on time as well. Ah, okay, we have another result. Can Skoog resign this game? E5, rook f6. Yeah, we don't have to look at this, it's just resignable, unfortunately. It was a really good game by Majorov, I have to admit. This I don't know, bishop f1 looks like a really nice idea. And if this works, then maybe this entire thing with queen b6, queen a6 wasn't that good. I mean, you have to look up these things. If you're going to play these grandmasters and knows the subtleties, what happened in the game, he was just much worse, I think. This bishop pair is too strong. And the position just collapsed very quickly here. Unfortunately. Kenny Skoog is he's a very talented player. He hasn't been working on chess for quite a while, but he really enjoys playing chess. He's working full time, I think, and he doesn't really play many tournaments, but at least he had the time to play this tournament, which I'm really happy about. Okay, let's look at Felix's position. Why did I look at Felix's position? I don't wanna look at this. This should drop off any time. Queen b1, I mean bishop b3, queen a2. This is horrible. Why does he keep doing this to himself? It's just horrible. No. Not gonna look at it. Do we have any other? Okay, we have this. What happened here? I thought there wasn't much wrong with Hampus' position here. I thought he would take on f1. And then take on e4 and play queen d5. But rook a8 looks kind of passive. Queen e2. Take. King f. Now this doesn't look right. Rook e7. Something just went badly wrong here. g6. No, this is not correct. He's a pawn down. Does he have any drawing chances? He should have some drawing chances. For sure. But they're not very bright. I mean, the good thing about keeping the rook here is that the king can't be activated very quickly. But at the same time, this king can't. You have to play something like. Nah. Now, white is probably just going to advance on the king side. Maybe h4. Maybe bring the king up. Because, I mean, you can't really move the rook. If you want to go something like this, activating the king, then you just go rook c6 and it's losing, so. I think this is the kind of position that maybe black draws it sometimes, but it's easier to lose it. And definitely, if you're playing a stronger player, Vigner is more experienced, and even though Hampus is very talented, I think he's going to have a hard time. Maybe he can play rook d7. King f7 and activate it this way, but I mean, still the rook now it has to be losing, objectively losing. Even though, you have to be careful with white, but it should be losing, which is of course very good for the Icelandic prodigy. What else is going on? Ooh, Hambleton against Panzer. Took an h2, king h1, b takes c6. What's going on? So he's trying to survive this knight f6 stuff. So I'm gonna update because there's too much markers. Here we go. Okay, so knight f6, you have to go king h8. And you don't really win this piece, right? Because you can take on f1. And, yeah, I mean, this looks kind of scary, but it's not going to win the game. Black is always on knight d5 stuff, so this isn't right. There's something here that should win the game. I'm not really sure what, but it's there somewhere. I mean, even taking this next move, if you move the queen somewhere, it looks extremely risky because this king is so weak, but yeah. Hambleton is down on 1 minute. What happened? Did play him? What move did he make? No, it's Milton's move, I think. Then why is the time run? Sorry, I'm gonna have to update. This game is extremely interesting. And I have to admit, I have not understood one single move of this game. There's even moves like rook d6 here. Did I consider that? I don't think so. The queen has to go somewhere. Queen h5. But knight f6 looks so good, so I want to make it, but maybe there's something better. Yeah, I don't know. Milton is thinking, at least. It feels like White is winning here. I'm sure he is somehow, but where is the right move? Yeah. Is here somewhere. Well, it doesn't look very good if I just keep thinking all by myself in live TV, but yeah. I'm just not really good at calculating, I guess. What happened here? What happened? Sorry, I have to go back. What happened? F5. We had this position. Rook e7. So he just sacrificed his own queen. Took on e7. This might be interesting. I don't know, maybe it's interesting. I think it's interesting. But I also like queen sacrifices, so I'm biased as well. I mean, if you get these knights coordinated, then I think black should be alright, but I'm not really sure. I mean, if the knight gets to e5, then absolutely black should be okay, but does it really get the knight to e5? I don't think so. I mean, I can always play knight to 3, there's some weakness around the king as well. Maybe white can play queen f6 here, attacking, but just knight f5. But the king still looks weak. I mean, this has to be good for white, but black is kind of fighting. Maybe knight e2, rook f8, queen e6, knight f4. I'm just making a couple of moves. I'm not sure. I'm sure there are better moves both sides, but it looks interesting. I don't think black can aim to win this game, but Blomqvist sure has to find some good moves to win it. Interesting queen sacrifice for sure. But he shouldn't be able to win it, definitely. He has to fight for a draw, Mihailov, and he's a burst on time, and Eric is a very strong player. So my money is on Eric's winning this game, but yeah. Mihailov has been playing an interesting game. I'm still not completely sure about this move queen g4, which he played early in the game. This move looks kind of strange to me, but obviously he wants to play a move like knight d7 without the bishop hanging, but I'm not really sure the queen is so good in h5. Okay, Blomqvist played knight e2 immediately, probably wanting to play knight f4, which Mihailov prevents with rook f8. Yeah, I mean, White has to fight to win this game. Maybe he can play b4 at some point. Maybe not now, but the idea is here. And the pawns is kind of, I mean, if it takes, these pawns are weak. You don't want to take that pawn. But if you take, you have to protect b7. It's an interesting idea. I mean, rook f2 at some point, but now maybe just king g1 is good for White. I don't know what's going on. Are there any more results? Not really. We have 3 results so far. We have a draw between Tukayev and Trygistad. We have a win for Majorov against Kenneth Skog. And we have a very quick win for Risting against Kwasam. Next time I'm gonna try to get Risting into the studio. I think he would like to maybe show his game maybe some other day. Now I think it's too late to catch him, but okay. I think Westerberg has won another pawn, so he's 2 pawns up. White is trying to create something against the king. I don't like this at all. Okay, maybe he will get the pawn on h6 back, but I mean the center should be good. Yeah. White is fighting, but I don't think it will be enough. I'm not even gonna look at Felix's game because he's probably just a piece down still. Oh, okay, let's look. Milton, what's going on? Did he play? B takes c6. He played rook takes f7. That's a brilliant move. Obviously, if you take here, then knight f6, and you just win the queen. This is genius. Or I'm just unusually bad for today, but okay, let's look at King H8, which is what Hambleton played. I still don't see the knockout punch, even though the position looks quite good for white if rook takes f7 is played without being punished. I mean, just a move like rook f2, right? Must be good. And if you take, then bishop takes f7. Yeah, this has to be really good. I mean, queen, I don't know, queen h7. Well, I can just maybe start taking pawns. No, I think Milton is doing really well. I doubt he will lose this game. And, yeah. Oh, wow, what happened here? I think this game was being quite dull for a while because nothing happened too much, but something had really happened here. Bishop g4. Strikes me as kind of weird, actually. Not really sure that I like this move. Take, take, rook c5. So black is trying to get active, but I mean, can he really achieve it? I mean, this pawn is not so easy to win. I mean, white can always play a4. I mean, e4. That's exactly the kind of move that I did not want to play, but apparently he has some kind of idea. Knight d4, f4. So obviously he wants to. This has to be the move white has to play. I mean, this knight on d4 is extremely strong if it gets to be there, but after f4, queen h8 was played by Hansen, and that doesn't look right. If he has to play a move like queen h8, it doesn't look right. Then maybe this move e4 and f4 was just very good for Erik. Maybe knight d5 or something here. Just putting the knight actively. I'm still a bit worried about playing e4 and f4 around the king, but I mean, suddenly the queen on h8 and the knight on d4 looks kind of, I don't know, it's maybe you can even consider move like e5 and the knight e4. This looks really interesting. E5 looks good. The knight is hanging. Knight e4 threatens here, threatens here. It would be extremely good if Erik won the first game with white. A couple of months ago, he was a 2100 player and quite a good one. And then he just played extremely well, starting from, I think, Real Time Cup. He was very close to achieving in International Master Norm. Then he in Hasselbacken, he actually got the International Master Norm. I think he even played Shirov in the final round. Extremely good tournament, and he has been playing extremely well. He's a 2300 player for sure. He played e5. This just looks really good for white. I'm a bit worried that the queen might need a couple of moves to get active. I mean, knight b3 maybe, but I mean, the queen on h8, you can't really complain about the queen being on b4. So knight e4, knight f6. The game is still far from over, but I'm pretty sure white is better here. But of course, no, they're both from quite low on time, so a lot can happen. Okay, let's do it. Let's look at Felix's position, even though I don't want to. E4 was played. So obviously he needs some kind of tactical idea behind knight takes b4. Extremely greedy, but it's a pawn. What's the idea here? I'm not really sure. It feels like it's extremely bad for black, and probably still is extremely bad for black, but I don't see like a knockout punch here. E5, e6 is always should always be considered, but here I think e5 just knight d5. And black is, well, fighting at least. Did you really want to? This doesn't look like the ideal solution. Knight takes b4. It has to be something extremely wrong with that move, because I don't think this is what white wanted otherwise. But I don't see it. The knight is kind of trapped, but I don't see how to win it. Yeah, but I mean, even if it's still a pawn down, I mean, white has to be better, but why did he allow knight takes b4? Technically, it's not really a pawn you want to give up because, well, it's an important pawn, but. Well, I have to see. There are a lot of interesting stuff going on here. I think we should look at Westerberg's position because something is going down. Okay, White actually played c5 as a sacrifice. You could play queen a4 here, but then b5 and everything's just covered, so that's not the idea. Queen h5, f4. So, he actually got this. White has two rooks for the queen. Somehow it feels like White is doing much better than he used to. It feels like White has done something. Sorry, Black has done something very wrong here because the rooks are kind of active. The pawns aren't that dangerous, and maybe he just got tricked. Westerberg, rook c1. What is going on? I mean, queen d5 doesn't look right, king b5. And if he plays here, then rook c8, I guess. I think something has gone wrong for Westerberg. I don't think he's losing. Maybe he's probably still better, but this is not going to be easy to win. I'm not really sure if he's better. Yeah. Okay, let's look at some other games. Anyway, Westerberg, he has a much better time. The Indian player Rakesh is down in 1 minute, and it's kind of tricky playing with two rooks against the queen when you have low time, because the rooks are kind of easy to blunder. You have to watch out for checks and all the stuff. Queen is just easy. You know how the queen moves. So I think psychologically, Westerberg is still doing all right, but how is he going to win this? He has to somehow play, I mean, queen g6, e5, e4, take an f3 and play against the king, I guess. Something like that. I mean, the pawns are looking not so dangerous. Rook c8, I guess, has to be the idea. Maybe this rook. Okay, something's happened in Milton's game. Let's see if we can understand the position this time. I'm gonna update to see if we have any more moves as well. Here we go. Rook takes f7, king h8, rook f2, and it just went rook e8. Hamilton is extremely low on timer. And the position just looks horrible. I'm always bad at winning in chess anyway, but queen c1 is played by Milton. Let's see. He can take the knight. But it feels like something is going to happen. Queen g5? Looks like a move. Threatening mate. You can check here, right? No, maybe you can't because rook f1. What's going on? Can you take on e5? It feels like there's a mate there. Sorry, I'm keeping my eyes on all the boards at the same time. Okay, if you take on e5, at least you can take back the piece on g4, and this attack looks really dangerous, so. But if you check here, you can't really play king takes h2, because then this works alright, I think. So you have to play rook f1 here. But then it looks alright. Queen takes e5. Now you can at least take here, even though it feels like I'm missing something easy. Feels like I'm missing a lot of things today, I'm not sure. I have to wake up earlier, I think. So what else is going on? Queen g5, do we have anything else? We can't really play passively. Yeah, this queen c1 move, it looks extremely. I don't know what it looks like even. It looks clever. What did he play? He played knight d5. That's probably a good move. but in a bad position, are there any good moves really? But I mean, blocking the bishop can't be wrong, and I mean, yeah, white's position has to be winning objectively, but I mean, he has to win the position as well. Knight d6, perhaps? Well, you have to calculate, rook takes e5. I think it's a very good thing for Milton that he's on much better time here than Hambleton is. Hambleton's on 1 minute. Having this position is not very promising. I think one of the good things about Milton is he's not really kind of player that really wants a draw. I've seen a lot of juniors play like con variations, just wants a draw, but Milton is he wants to win. His openings are kind of lame, I think, but if he gets his chance and he's better, he's not the kind of guy who just takes a draw if he's playing someone better. And here he really shows that he's a very good chess player. Yeah, I think it's a matter of time before his father is no longer the best player of the family. So far I think Pontus is still better, but yeah, within a year or two I think Milton is going to be a strong, at least international master. He played knight g5. I still have no idea what's going on. Bishop b1 looks like one idea that has to be considered. And I guess one idea is that rook takes e5 doesn't work because of rook of 8 and there's a mate. Yeah, this is mate. I'm always happy when I see something at least. Knight g5. Not every day that I see something. Knight g5, yeah, it looks very dangerous. Bishop b1 is about to be played. And if the queen has to go to like h6 or h5, then mate is coming shortly. What's going on? Bishop e6 is played. Okay, so bishop f1 here. Bishop b1. Can't even say the names correctly. Queen h5? And I don't know, should it take here? This should be mate also, right? Yeah, this is mate. I'm always happy when I see a mate, but yeah, this looks good. Bishop b1 should be winning. Which is of course extremely good for the Swedish fans. Blomqvist still fighting. Knight g3, knight f5. Mihailov is obviously not afraid of exchanging knights. But I don't think he should be. He has one pawn and one piece and a rook for the queen, which is sufficient. But I mean, the queen is always kind of tricky and the pieces aren't really coordinating well here. So let's look at taking here and play queen f4. Looks aggressive, but doesn't do anything. You could always just play rook f8. I think black should be able to hold this, but it's not easy. Yeah, I think Erik is still a bit better, but I don't really think he's winning. Probably a very clever queen sacrifice by Mihailov, so maybe he'll be able to hold a draw. Maybe he can start checking here, but probably not. You have to watch out for the checks at least. Okay, let's see what else is going on. Ooh, Milton won his game. What happened? Bishop b6, knight takes e5, and Hambleton resigned. What happened? Is it resignable? No. He's still making moves. Now queen takes e6. Okay, it's probably something wrong with the program. He's still making moves. You don't make moves when you resign. Okay. No. He hasn't resigned, sorry. Queen takes e6, and now what? Queen g5? Maybe queen e5. Because if you take on e5, now I think we have rook f8. And that should win. I hope. But, okay, let's say queen h6. I don't really have an engine working, so I would really need an engine right now to tell me what's going on. But it would be kind of unfair for the players who don't have an engine at the board. Yeah, it's not refinable. White should definitely be much better here. That's not resignable. Queen g5 actually looks like a really strong move, but you have to find something after queen h6. I mean, even if he would trade the queens, I think he's winning quite easily, but you really want a mate him. You don't want to trade the queens. It feels bad trading queens when the king on h8 is so bad. What else is going on? Hampus is not really improving his position, but White's position is improving. Doesn't look good for Hampus, unfortunately. Do we have any other boards? We have Westerberg. Wow. Did he really have to play King H3? Okay, so probably if you go to f1, we just pick up this pawn, and that should be winning for black. I'm not really sure why the rook went to c8. Why that rook? I would have gone with this rook, just keeping everything protected, because I'm not sure what these rooks are threatening. I mean, king h3 does not look good. I mean, the king on h3, e5, rook b8, king a6, rook e8, can you play at some point just queen g1, start picking up all the pawns? What is white supposed to do? This looks winning for white, for black, sorry. Yeah, I don't like this move, rook c8 at all. I would have gone with the other rook. Anyway, maybe he's having a hard time, but after this, maybe he's just losing. And the program says that he resigned. Or lost on time. I'm never sure. This program isn't perfect. I haven't looked much at this game, mostly because I'm extremely biased and I tend to look at the Swedish juniors most, but Stefan Pogosian and Shama Hemant, I think they're both really young players. I think Hemant is an international master, but he's definitely not going to win this game. He's a pawn down, his king looks kind of weak, and it looks like white is just much better, right? Yeah, this looks very bad. There are a lot of upsets in this tournament. I guess that's what happened when there's a lot of juniors playing, and all the players are really strong. I mean, we have a limit of 2200 ELO, which is definitely, if you have 2200 in ELO, you're really a strong player, and anything can happen. We saw that Tukayev had, he could have played on in that rook endgame, which he would have done against any extremely weak player, I'm pretty sure, but against Kyrgyzstan, I mean, he didn't even want to fight in it. He just played a safe draw. So, what's going on? Felix, he just loses. He resigned. It seems like everything is just dropping. Yeah, I mean, I don't know why he resigned now. The bishop is on a8, and even if white takes it, he's a piece up, which is, he's been a piece up the whole game anyway. And I'm definitely gonna tease him for this after the game. I don't even think he's mad about this game. He's just, it happens. Lundqvist, Mihailo, King h7. What happens if knight g3? You can just take it with check. But do you really want to? I mean, knight g7 looks better. Yeah, white is going to fight for a win, but I'm not really sure he's going to make it. Okay, so if everything's alright here, it seems like Westerberg is winning, or won his game, sorry. And Bajarani won his game against Tuominen, but I mean, strategically he was worse after like, well, 7 moves. And he never really got his bishop into play. This is what happens when you don't know any theory, and yeah, I mean, not really a good game by Felix. He has to come better out of the opening if he wants anything to do in fighting for norms in this tournament. Okay, let's look at turns game, because that was really interesting. Let's see, knight e4, h5, okay, I didn't really look at this, but it makes sense. Queen c3. Okay. I'm thinking a lot. What happens if you take the bishop? Probably take on d4. Not really sure. Well, let's see. Queen d8. Bishop f3, I guess, has to be played. Rook takes b5. And this game has turned extremely tactical as well. Knight f6 has to be considered, but I'm looking at knight d6 now. The rook is attacked. This one might be attacked. f7 is weak. At some point, f5 or e6. Okay, he played knight d6. Still looks good. I mean, if you calculate the pawns, then sure, black is a pawn up, but I mean, looking at the knight, the king, the pieces just look good. And if maybe tactically it just doesn't work out for black, because rook takes d4 is on the cards as well. I think Eric is having a good, some good play here, but okay, Milton. That game is still going on. He didn't resign Hamilton. He took on d5. C takes, queen f4, rook d8, rook f3, so obviously he just wants to mate him now, but how? I haven't really looked at the pawns. 1, 2, 3, okay, it's equal pawns, but yeah, I mean, this one's gonna drop off. This one can take an end time. So even in an endgame, I think Milton is winning. And here, I think maybe he's even threatening moves like, I mean, rook f6, and you can't really take it because mate and stuff. What else? Oh, he played king g8. That's interesting. So what's going on here? You can't really play rook f6, of course. You can probably just take it, right? But you can take on a7. At which point you can't really take on e5, but you can move this pawn, I guess. This still looks bad. Yeah, he took on a7. So Milton is a pawn up, but black is fighting. I guess he has to play d4 or something. He has to create some kind of counterplay. And it feels like white has some sacrifice around here at any time, which would win the game. Yeah, he played d4. What happened? Let's look at rook g3. And you have to protect g7 somehow. So look at... what should we try? Rook e7? This also looks kind of scary. Maybe white could even play a move like queen g5. Maybe. But I mean, d4 has to be right at least. I mean, black doesn't have anything in the position, so he has to go with the d-pawn far away. Felix is here picking up his backpack. Probably filled with shame. And Yeah, I think what happened? D4, he took on G7, rook G3, and it's mate, right? It should be mate. Okay, so king H7, he can play queen E4, and this is mate, right? So it looks like Milton is winning his game against Hambleton, if everything is looking alright. Yeah. Well, extremely good game by Milton, I guess, even though I'm not really sure what was going on during the most of the game, queen e4. Yeah, I'm impressed. I mean, I wouldn't have understood anything about this game by Milton, but apparently he did, at least better than Hambleton. And yeah, Hambleton might just allow him to mate him or resign or I don't know. Very impressive by Milton. I'm impressed. Hopefully he will join me here in the commentary room. There are not so many games going on anymore. We have still a return. What is going on? Everything just moves so quickly these days. Queen c7, take on d4. c3. And this is one of those chaotic positions that... Okay, black is trying to get a new queen, which he probably will manage to, but... This king still looks really weak. I mean, what has to try some e6 or f5 stuff quickly? Really quickly. e6 looks critical. Ah, no, he played knight e8. So the knight's probably coming here. You can even play e6 next move for the mate on g7, so... Yeah, knight e8 looks like a really good move, if I'm not missing anything. But okay, queen c5. But then we have check, and maybe queen d8, threatening mate. This looks... I don't know what it looks like, but if you have to play queen f8, then I guess white is doing alright. No, queen c4 isn't a move, so... I think they're both in time trouble. Okay, rook b2 was played. Ah, interesting. So if you go king h3, we have queen c8 picking up the knight. That's quite clever. So we probably can't go to h3 with the king. Which means we have to go back, but then... Can we play c2? Everything is on pre, but maybe it's just alright. This rook b2 looks quite good. He played king f1. But still, can he play c2? Is c2 just winning? Looks that way. There's something tactical about this game that Eric missed. I'm not sure what, because I can't calculate either, but maybe it's just losing here. I would try something like e6. But something just... Okay, I would lie if I understood anything about the position here anyway, but... Yeah, it looks like it was some kind of time trouble. Scramble that decided this game, and probably Eric, Mads Hansen just calculated better in the time pressure. And, but C2 just appears to be winning, I think. Or not, because he didn't play it. Why can't you play C2? I must be missing something extremely easy. I mean, you can take this queen, but I mean, I get a new one. You play bishop d1, rook d2, and you can resign. Right? I don't get it. What am I missing? He played queen c5 instead. Which might, of course, be winning as well, but... Okay, maybe this is even easier, because there's a mate on f2. C2 looked flashier. I mean, all the pieces were hanging. Just play c2. It looks nicer, but... Knight f6, And I'm guessing the king has to go to, let's say, king g7. And is there no way you can save this? Let's try knight e8 again. No, I think just king f8. And black wins. You can't move the queen. It feels like I'm calculating extremely badly today. Or maybe I'm just bad at chess, I don't know. Any more results? Okay, Philipp Lindgren won his game against Erdem. Sorry, Philipp, I haven't seen your game too much. I mean, we saw a couple of moves, but. Okay, what happened here? Knight takes e4. He tried his tactical thing. Rook c1. And apparently it didn't work out at all. Queen b4. I have no idea what the idea of this was. g4, queen b3, what is a piece up? And it's a good place to resign. Yeah, this wasn't very impressive by the young player from Mongolia. Even though Philipp played well, I think. He got a good opening, played a good game, took a couple of pieces. What else do we have? We have Pogosian playing Hermant, and you can't really stop this pawn, can you? Too weak. Yeah, this is just winning for Pogosian as well. You can resign this game. Where else do we have? Eric's game is still one of the most interesting. Maybe we should update to get some more moves. King h2. He has some kind of progress. The queen is on g6, which looks kind of annoying. And it feels like this looks good for white now, but I'm not sure how. I mean, black is kind of stuck. Is this a zugzwang? He can play rook g8, right? What's the last move? Rook f8, king h2. And I mean, this knight can't really move, right? Because knight takes d6. This one can't move because of h6 is hanging. And the thing is, if you play knight g3 next move, then I think you can play knight g7 with black, but king h2 just looks very clever. Okay, rook g8 has to be played, I guess. No, sorry, the rook has to protect him. Is this a zugzwang position? It's an extremely pretty one. I don't see. It looks like Eric is winning. Wow. Well, I mean, I don't even know what to say, but it's very, very, very neat. It looks like Eric is winning. I don't see a move for black. I guess the best you can do is something like, you can't even go here, can you? Because you have knight f6, and there's a mate on h7. Wow. What a nice position. That was actually really nice. Okay, let's look at Erik Thörn's game. B takes c5. How do you stop this pawn? You have to go bishop e4, I guess. And then c2, but this is just losing. Seems like Erik will lose that game. What else do we have? We still have the final board. We haven't looked at this game at all. We have Tiku Sahil, who is, I think, the lowest rated player in the tournament, is playing Martin Haubro, the Danish player. Yeah, maybe you want to join? Show your game? Okay. We'll take a short break and see what we have Eric here. Okay, I think we're back, and we're joined by Erik Blomqvist, who won his game against Mihailov. Even though the result isn't on the live board, he won his game. And I don't know, did you have any time to prepare the game?
Not really. But I saw he played the King's Indian.
Okay, so did you decide beforehand that you were going to play this, if you played the King's Indian, or did you just decide?
No, I just decided it over the board.
Okay. Have you played this B3 before?
Yes, a few times. I played it in the Swedish League yesterday.
Okay. So, you who did you play yesterday?
Jörgen Eriksson.
Okay.
Swedish player.
Did he play the same setup that Mihailov played? Or?
No, he played C5 here.
Okay.
C5. That's another move.
Yeah. But anyway, I think this bishop F5, I've seen this a couple of times. Is this the... Do you think it's one of the better variations for black against this, or...?
Well, I didn't know about this.
Okay.
Okay, I've seen it against C4, of course.
Well, I thought all the moves around here were quite natural. I was not really sure about Queen G4.
Well, it was quite interesting how he played this. To enable him to play Knight E7.
Okay. Well, I guess that was the idea, but... It looked kind of weird to me, but I guess the queen is quite good on h5 anyway.
Yeah, it's fine.
So queen d2. And here you decided to take on h3 and...
Yeah, actually here it already seemed to me that black was okay, more or less.
Okay.
Because I didn't see how to play.
So you took on h3, knight g5. So you think that black is just alright here?
Yes, probably.
And, yeah. Were you surprised by any of his decisions here, e4?
Well, a lot of them, I mean, it was not obvious, but... I mean, it looked playable.
Well, e5 here was interesting. I guess you kind of have to take on e6 if you want anything, but...
Yes.
But he still gets the f-file, and... Even though the pawn on d6 is kind of weak, you...
Yes, this position is a bit unclear.
Yeah, and g5, I guess he wants the square on e5 for the knight, or...
Sure.
If he gets time, I guess knight e5 and g4 is what he wants to play. But...
Actually, maybe he could have played g4 right now.
Immediately.
I would like to play h3, but if it takes h3, knight takes, and knight... Or queen f3, followed by knight e5.
Yeah, it looks alright for black, right? I think. I don't even know where the king is supposed to go, but...
Well, it's not so easy to drive the queen away from f3.
Yeah. Looks alright for black. You think g4 is what he should have played, or...?
No, I think what he played was also quite logical.
Alright. So knight e5, f4.
Yes, it takes. Knight c6 is also interesting.
Ah, to go to d4.
Yes.
Did you think you were better here, or do you think it was worse? Or?
Well, I wasn't sure. I might be worse.
Alright. I had no idea. Knight g6. I thought that it was quite interesting, but queen g4.
Yes, so now I play this f5, which is a pawn sacrifice, but it seemed to me that I will have at least enough activity.
Yeah, the knight on d5 is really strong. Around here I thought you were, at least your position was much better, easier to play than black's.
Sure.
He has a weak king, and yeah, the knight on d5 is really good. So.
My only problem is the knight on g1 is not really participating.
Yeah. Knight g7, you think you played something wrong around here? You think you could have defended better?
I think knight g7 was fine. And e7, I thought you could play knight e6 here.
Knight e6, and okay, let's see what's going on.
I can take on b7. I can play queen e4 maybe. There's some endgame. But maybe I have pressure.
I think I was looking at this endgame, and I thought maybe you were slightly better because he has some weakness here.
Yes, and especially my active rook gives me some.
Yeah. But okay, I mean, were you surprised that you sacrificed the queen?
A little bit. But maybe it was not so clear still.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't expect it, but I didn't see exactly how you were going to play. I thought I was looking at queen f6 here, but I wasn't sure if it led to anything.
I think you will play knight e2 f5.
And then knight e2?
Rook f8.
Okay, so this isn't, I don't know, queen g6.
Yes. There's no. Yeah, knight e3, I have.
I don't know, knight g3 maybe?
Yes.
I don't know, maybe. It's. I still wasn't sure how you were going to win it, but. Knight g3. Do you think this position is a draw, or do you think you're winning?
I think I have good winning chances.
During the game, it felt like
you almost had a fortress here.
Yeah, I mean, if you take on f5, this looks really difficult to win, actually. If you, I'm really sure, I really see how you're supposed to win it, but maybe there's some way. But knight e4 is probably a better idea, like you played it, just keeping the knights.
Maybe.
Because knight e8 kind of gets passive, and here you found a really nice idea, which I didn't really see myself until you played it. H5.
Yes, it looks like he played too passive.
Yeah, but I mean, somewhere around here he's already very passive, I guess.
Hmm.
He can't really play in knight g7, I guess, because d6 is hanging and so on. And here, of course, you got a real nice.
Maybe king f8 was.
King f8.
Better defense.
So you have this move, or?
Exactly. Okay. So it's queen g6, king e7. King h2, king f8.
Yeah.
Now I can play knight g3.
You can play knight g3. And if knight g7?
Yes, maybe it's not so easy.
Yeah.
If I can get knight to e6, could that be? Say knight e2.
Knight e2. But I mean, okay. Maybe you can stop knight d7 or something.
D6. Ah, okay. Because rook f2.
Yeah, I thought so. I still have no idea what's going on, but at least king f8 has to be a better try, because king h8 was just losing immediately.
Yes.
Then queen g6. This is actually a real nice idea, king h2. Did he resign here?
Yes, he resigned here.
Yeah.
Because there's no move, simply.
Yeah. That's actually a real nice position. Have you seen anything else from the games today? There has been a lot of upsets, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any games still going on? No, it seems like all the games are finished. Okay, but you won your game, Majorov won his game. Tokayev just managed to draw his game against Trugestad, quite a boring game, actually. Westerberg won, Bajarani won, but then, for example, Kosen lost his game very quickly against Risting.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like he blundered here. G3, just bishop takes G3, and everything just loses for white.
Sure.
And Milton, of course, is the big result of the day for the Swedish guys. He won his game against the Canadian Hamilton. And I understand nothing of this game. Everything is just hanging everywhere. And apparently, it was just a very good play by Milton, but yeah, it was too complicated for me. And then Pogosian won his game also against Hamant. I didn't really look at these games too carefully on the lower boards. But anyway, quite a lot of upsets. And there's a double round tomorrow, right? We start at 10 o'clock. I think I will start at 11 o'clock, so I can sleep more. And okay. Yeah, good luck tomorrow, and thank you for today.
Thanks.